What is an IoT framework? An Internet of Things framework, it's a set of tools, protocols, standards that help us develop a whole IoT system. To be more clear about what, in general terms, a framework is, we can think about a task, building a castle, a small one. We can build it with Lego bricks. So Lego construction system, it's our framework. And the way we take the pieces and put it together are the way that this framework allows us to work. So it's a set of blocks, literally the Lego blocks, and tools in order to get this built. But we can also have the same result with different frameworks. So if we want a castle, we can use cardboard, we can use sand, and there's different frameworks, different set of tools and things in order to accomplish that task. When we talk about IoT, we talk about a lot of components. So in IoT, you have the device, and the device has hardware, has firmware, has connectivity to the cloud, has all the protocols of how it's connected, has the cloud. So there are a lot of elements within the IoT concept, and there can be frameworks to have an overall of the system, of the communications, of the cloud, of the software, of the hardware. But bear in mind that this can be a little bit overwhelming, but the frameworks are out there to make our life easier. In this video, I'm gonna give you examples of frameworks of the cloud to be a little bit more concrete. And I'm gonna talk about open source frameworks, things that the code is available and you can get it and run it, and other frameworks that are not necessarily open source. That doesn't mean necessarily that this is free and this is not free. There are free tiers of closed frameworks, and they are paid tiers of open source frameworks. So just bear that in mind. About the proprietary IoT frameworks for the cloud, I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about AWS IoT, about Azure IoT, and also KAA IoT. Amazon Web Services IoT, or AWS, is one of the big players in the terms of cloud solutions, and their IoT solutions have a lot of blocks. For example, we can see some of them here. This is not specifically on the cloud. This is on the device. It's FreeRTOS, is an embedded operating system. And what it does, it's make it easier for it to connect to the device, to the cloud. They have things like AWS IoT Core. They have things like a digital twins or twin maker. Those are the blocks that you can use in order to get a solution going. And here are some examples of how to use it. A lot of documentation and things, companies that have used them. Azure IoT is the solution from Microsoft. And it's very similar as AWS in terms of what can be achieved. They also show use cases, architectures, and these are the blocks. So Azure IoT Hub, it's one of the main. AWS had FreeRTOS. This has their own RTOS, real-time operating system, Azure RTOS, that is on the device side, not in the cloud side, but everything to build a better solution. They have also digital twins. You can see more information and applications here in their webpage. KAA IoT, it's a solution that used to be open source, and in some moment they decided to make it proprietary. And this is different from the last two because AWS and Azure are cloud providers, and in general, you can do a lot of things with them. This is more focused on IoT in a whole. So I'll show you more about the dashboards, what it can be made. Let's see some IoT dashboard for example, fleet management. Here you can see a little bit more what is shown, and you can see live dashboards. And here you can get the vibe of what the dashboard looks like with more gauge interaction, stop engine, lock the trunk, graph, etc. So basically this kind of dashboard you can make with all the tools, but in the first two you have to get a little bit more understanding on the tool in order to get the right components. This kind of solution is a little bit more preset in terms of getting from a hardware sending to the cloud to certain protocols like HTTP, MQTT, and be able to get a dashboard much easier than the other solutions. But the other ones tend to be more customizable in terms of the how you can change the blocks. So that's something to have in mind. In the open source side, I'm gonna talk to you about ThingsBoard, OpenHAB, and DeviceHive, that they solve the problem with different approach. I would say that ThingsBoard is one of my favorites because it allows you to have IoT solution there in a very easy way. And as it is open source, you can implement it in your own server and have more control about it. And if you don't like something specific about it, you can go into the source code and change it. It also has things like alarms. You can put rules in order to have more interaction without having to do code, but block-based. So that's very interesting. And as I was mentioning, they have different tiers. So they have the community edition, that is the open source one, the professional edition, and the cloud. So community edition, you can get the source code and run it on your server. Professional edition, it's not open source. You have to pay in order to get it complete. And cloud eliminates the hassle of mounting your own server yourself. So you want to get going with this, you just select the cloud one and just start sending information to the cloud without having to hassle with the cloud implementation, basically. And as you can see, in terms of prices, community edition is 100% open source. It's free. Professional edition has different costs depending on the amount of devices or the data points, depending on whether or not are cloud or self-managed. Self-managed can be pay as you go, or it can be perpetual, so you can buy it once and get it all the time depending on what you're thinking. So you can see that there are many ways of getting it, and this is mainly open source, but they have different business models regarding it. OpenHAB is interesting, and I want to implement one of these because it's focused on smart home. So we see things that are more general, like AWS and Azure, that you can do pretty much everything. So other ones that have their dashboard, it's easier to connect to tools like this, that it's specifically for smart home. It wants to be hardware agnostic, meaning that you can connect pretty much any smart device into it, and that you can run it on the cloud, but you can also get a Raspberry Pi and run it locally, so you don't have to get your information from your house. But if you wanted to run it in the cloud, then you can do it like this. No cloud required, but cloud friendly. And here we can see the list of supported things. It also supports Alexa and Google Home and Apple. It has a lot of integration, so it makes it very powerful. And it's open source, so that it's very cool. DeviceHive, it's interesting. It's a little bit like ThingsBoard in terms that it allows you to create a general IoT solution, but you have to be a little bit more tech savvy in order to run it. It does have a playground. And for example, they are not focused on doing the whole thing. They focus on the backend, getting the information from the device to the cloud and being able to process it, maintain it, etc. And for example, for the front end, for being able to see the dashboard, they use another tool that it's called Grafana, that it's open source. So they take advantage of other open source tools in order to get things going. When you go to the playground area, whether other solutions show you a dashboard when you can see things going, it gives you API URL, some access and things, so you can play, but having a device, sending it to the cloud, and then reviewing that it's there. And you can get access to the admin console, to the dashboard that it's powered by Grafana. So it's interesting. You have to do a little bit more steps. And from the webpage, I see that you can download the code and you can run it on your own server, on your own computer, but you don't have necessarily the option to run it online in their cloud and just pay and go. So those are different approaches that each company takes. As you can see, there are different approaches depending on how general or how specific they are, if they provide the whole part of the solution of the connection, if they add more blocks that you can play with or not. An idea is that if you're implementing an IoT solution, you get the right tools in order to build your solution. For example, if you want to make a proof of concept very fast, you can go to ThingsBoard and pay their cloud solution or use their free tier for the proof of concept. And if you know that you are gonna deploy 100,000 millions of devices and you need something that is very robust and that you can have more flexibility with the blocks, maybe you can go with one of the big cloud providers like AWS or Azure to implement the solutions there. Some question that we get a lot is what's the difference then between a framework and an architecture? Basically, it's a little bit similar to the example with the castle. So the architecture will be the way that you think about it, having two towers, a door, etc., etc. And the framework is whether or not you use it Lego bricks, you use cardboard, you use sand in order to make it. And in our case, for example, you can have an architecture and you can have the same architecture implemented in AWS and Azure. They share a lot of the blocks. They are named different, but basically they do the same. So there you go. And if you want support or assistance in your IoT product, you can contact us, DeepSea Developments, and we can help you get things going. If you like this video, please share and subscribe. And if you have any comment, please put it in the box below.